Good evening. So I'd like to welcome you to just a celebration of life of Bob Oswald. I thank you for being here tonight just to show your love and respect to Bob and his family. I'd like to start by just reading some scripture. Psalm 90 says this. It says, Lord, through all the generations you have been our home. Before the mountains were born, before your birth to the earth, before you gave birth to the earth and the world, from beginning to end, you are God. You turn people back to dust, saying, return to dust, you mortals. For you, 1,000 years were like a passing day, as brief as a few hours. You sweep people away like dreams that disappear. They're like grass that springs up in the morning, and in the morning it blooms and flourishes, but by evening it's dry and withered. We wither beneath your anger. We are overwhelmed by your fury. You spread out our sins before you, our secret sins, and you see them all. We live our life beneath your wrath, ending our days with a groan. 70 years are given to us. Some even live to 80. But even the best years are filled with pain and trouble. Soon they disappear. We fly away. Teach us to realize the brevity of life so that we may grow in wisdom. Jesus said this. He said, don't let your heart be troubled. Do you believe in God? Believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way, you know. And Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you're going, and how can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. At the very end of the Bible, in Revelation, it says, John's writing, and he says, he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding from the throne of God and of the Lamb. And in the midst of its street and on either side of the river, there was a tree of life, which bore 12 fruits, each tree yielding its fruit every month. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. And there shall be no more curse, but the throne of God and the Lamb shall be in it, and the servants shall serve him. They shall see his face, and he shall be on their, and his name will be on their foreheads. There will be no night there. They need no lamp or light of the sun, for the Lord God gives them light, and they shall reign forever.
It's been a long year, it almost took me down, I swear. Life was so good, I'm not so sure we knew what we had. I'll never be the same man, I'll never feel like I felt before. It's been a hard year. there faithfully.
Lord, we thank you for Bob Osborne's life. It says in your word that we're supposed to praise you with our whole heart, so we praise your holy name. Lord, I'd ask that everything in us would praise you, and we wouldn't forget all the good things that you do for us. You forgive all our sin, you redeem us from death, you crown us with love and tender mercies, you fill our life with good things. Lord, you're compassionate, you're merciful, you're slow to anger, you're filled with unfailing love. You don't punish us for all our sins. You don't deal harshly with us like we deserve. Your unfailing love towards those that fear you, Lord, is as great as the heights of the heaven above the earth. You removed our sins as far as the east is from the west. You, Lord, are like a father to your children. You're tender, compassionate to those that fear you. We know how weak we are. We remember that we're just dust. Our days on earth are like grass, like wildflowers, we bloom and die. The wind blows and we're gone. But your love, Lord, remains forever for those who fear you. Your salvation extends to those who are faithful, to those who obey your commands. Lord, you made the heavens your throne, and from there you rule over everything. And so, Lord, we praise you. Let everything praise you. Everything in your kingdom, let everything that we are, Lord, praise you. In the name of your Son, Jesus, I pray. Amen. Robert Arnold Osborne, 70. Widow of the late Jeannie Maureen Stevens Osborne, died Saturday, January the 20th, 2024, at the North Point Healthcare Center in Lexington. He was born in Paris, Kentucky, to the late Dallas Sr. and Anna Pearl Fletcher Osborne. He was the owner, operator of Osborne Excavation. Robert enjoyed reloading ammunition, shooting, hunting, and anything that involved the outdoors. He was also an avid reader and loved going out to dinner with his wife. He's survived by one son, Derek, married to Ashley Osborne, two grandchildren, Case and Grayson Osborne, one brother, Dallas Osborne Jr., and one sister, Sandy, married to Fred Shortridge, and several nieces, nephews, and cousins. Funeral arrangements have been entrusted to Lusk McFarland Funeral Home. Derek has prepared some comments that he'd like to share.
I'll try not to mess your paperwork up here.
You're good.
So first, I would like to thank each of you who came here tonight and valued my dad enough to show your respect and condolences to me and my family. When I began thinking about what I was going to say, I found it quite difficult to put into words the life of my dad. Where do you begin? Where do you end? One would say that you would start and end with the dates that signify the beginning and end of his life on earth. However, it is the dash that separates these two dates that matters most and that my father exemplified, a life well lived and well loved. God blessed me with an amazing father, husband to my mother, son to my grandparents, brother to my aunt and uncle to my cousins. He also blessed the communities of Avon, Clintonville, and North Middletown by his friendship, caring, honesty, integrity, service, and work ethic. Music is a great form of communication of which I would like to use as a baseline to share about Dad. Hopefully each of you got to hear some of the words of the songs that were played as the pictures rolled across the screen. All of these songs came alive in my mind with vivid memories as they happened to play this past week, and I fully believe God provided these to help me and all of us remember and rejoice over my father. The first song was Years by John Anderson. The song describes what many of us know, and many sitting in the room are told of by older folks, but don't take it to heart. And that is the fact that time goes by quickly. Leanna and I were looking at pictures this week, realized that some of the photos of our parents were taken at a time in their lives in which we find ourselves in now, and how quickly it happens. That being said, I cherish every year I got to spend with my father. Growing up, I couldn't have asked for a cooler dad. Most little boys liked tractors, bulldozers, and heavy equipment. Played cowboys and Indians with friends, with imaginary guns and bows. Well, I hit the jackpot with Dad, because wouldn't you know it, he farmed, ran heavy equipment his whole life, enjoyed the outdoors, and was a firearm enthusiast. I can still remember sitting on the left side of the fuel tank of the loader riding with Dad as he worked, taking it all in. I would get tired and Dad would tell me to go to the truck and lay down, but I didn't want to leave, so he would roll up the tarp he would cover his seat up with at the end of the day, and I would lay down between the seat and roll cage and sleep for a spell. Now, I was much smaller at that time. Dad taught me the outdoors. We spent countless hours in the summer scouting for deer and making plans for the fall. He taught me how to fish. One thing he didn't teach me, rather, allowed me to experience on my own, was the wrath of a mother goose. We used to live in Avon, and there's a pond on what used to be Don Ross's farm. It's at the corner of Houston, Antioch, and Ware Road, if you don't know that. This hole of water had some really good fish in it. It was always pretty growed up around it, however, around the banks. You know, I proceeded to take off around the corner of the dam. Dad was still over there. He could see me briefly, but kind of lost me in the tall weeds. And Dad always got a kick out of telling this story, because I got around the corner. I said, I ran up on a mother goose, and she was protecting her goslings. I had never experienced anything like that before, but you can imagine, when you're only 3 or 4 foot tall, Mother Goose, with her arms spread wide open, hissing and biting, well, it might as well have been a fire-breathing dragon. And Dad just laughed and laughed, because all he saw was that little fishing pole, you know, kind of bouncing back and forth above the weeds as I was yelling and screaming, coming back to him. So, to Dad, he thought, as he continued to laugh, one would have thought he was at the table, sitting tableside listening to one of his favorite comedians, Jerry Clower. Years. Dad spent years being faithful to his family. He loved my mother dearly and loved all of his family. He spent years working in the excavation business alongside my grandfather, and years working alongside my grandparents on the farm, especially my grandmother after my grandfather passed away. Both my grandmother and father shared the same love for family, and Dad called her every evening, even if he had spent the day down there working the various chores that needed to be done. They were both cut from the same cloth. The second song is Ain't Got a Dollar by Oliver Anthony Music. Dad was a simple man. He wasn't fancy, didn't need much to keep him happy. He wasn't caught up in materialism, and as long as he got to hunt, shoot, and tinker with reloading, and go to dinner with Mom on a Saturday night, help his family out, he was pretty happy. By the world's standards, Dad wasn't rich, but for those of you who know him best and are here tonight, family, friendships, and the love, by all rights, he was wealthy. The third song is Fearless by Jackson Dean. I don't recall Dad ever being scared of anything. He faced challenges head on, and as the song says, Dad didn't mind the fight. This was a bit more literal in his younger days, and he wasn't opposed to taking on a challenge even if he lost. However, failure never entered his mind from what I saw. If you listen closely, the song describes a deep love between a man and a woman, and that is exactly what Dad shared with Mom. Sure, they disagreed on many things over the course of their marriage, as we all do, but rest assured, Dad would have walked through the gates of hell for Mom. When I was in my late teens, Dad had taken up the hobby of flying. All he had left to do was to get a single-engine pilot's license, was his solo flight that he never got around to completing. I had the chance to go to Mount Sterling with him once and fly in a beer can with wings and a Briggs and Stratton motor on it. It was evident to me at that time that Dad was fearless, or crazy, I don't know. Hard-Working Man by Brooks and Dunn. For those of you who know that my dad well, you know there is no point listening to the words of the song, as the title encompasses the character of my father. Dad grew up on the farm, and my grandparents instilled in him from a young age the value of strong work ethic, one that he maintained throughout his life and that he passed down to me, and hopefully I have passed down to my children. Dad was serious about work, and what he was also serious about was sleeping. Mom always said, don't mess with him while he's sleeping or eating. She was quite right about that. One night, we were still living in Avon. One of my friends and I were wrestling around in the bedroom, later than we should have been. Dad came in the room and told us to go to bed because he had to get up to go to work the next morning. The second time, the warning was a little bit more stern. The third time, Dad came in with a belt. The second swing, I caught the belt and tried jerking it away from him. I had a better chance of pulling a number 9 wire with butter on it out of a vise. I told him that was enough. Well, I suppose getting close to midnight, that was the last thing he wanted to hear. He proceeded to show me with the belt, in fact, that it was not enough. And I can be a slow learner, but I never did that again, and that was the last time I felt that belt. Last song was You've Got to Stand for Something by Aaron Tippett. And I always thought Dad resembled this gentleman a little bit. Dad lived this out in his life, and he taught me through his actions. He showed me to stand firm on truth and don't back down regardless of the opposition. He stood up for his family by caring for them, helping them out in need, and loving on all of us. He always provided for me and Mom with a roof over our head, food on the table, and even a new rifle or shotgun at Christmas that he would keep in hiding until he saw a sour look on my face after opening socks and underwear. Dad sacrificed himself for his family, period. When Dad's mind was made up on something, he stood his ground. When I was young, we went to church at David's Fork Baptist Church. Him and Mom dug their heels in and got involved in the church. Dad was baptized, and at this time, he stood for something else, God. They formed close relationships and grew in their faith. Regrettably, Dad witnessed some people in the church at their worst, and I didn't think he could wrap his mind around it. Dad was black and white. He had made a decision to follow Christ, but witnessing others not doing the same didn't sit well with him. This is when he quit going to church, sadly, rather than finding a church that stood tall like he did on God's word. In review of my father's life, there is no doubt that the love of God and the Holy Spirit indwelled him. If not, there is no way he would have been the husband, father, son, or brother that he was. In closing, I'm going to leave you with the most important and valuable conversation I ever had with my father. Came on the afternoon of Sunday, October 22nd, 2023. It was at the nursing home by myself, as I believe Ashley and the kids were at a band activity that day. I asked a few questions just before, just to establish a baseline of his cognition for that day, as I had done in the past. With the brain injury, some days he was a little clearer than others. This day, however, he was sharp, and the motions with his hand signals were quite evident. I asked him if he remembered getting baptized all those years back at David's Fork Baptist Church, and he gave me a thumbs up. I then asked him if he still believed that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and his personal Lord and Savior, and he clearly gave me a thumbs up. Even though I have lost my father, whom I love deeply, I have peace knowing that one day I will see him again, and if there is hunting in heaven, we will be chasing game together. As you look in the mirror this evening, is this a conversation that you need to have with yourself? Is this a conversation that you have been meaning to have with a loved one? As the aforementioned song Years describes, time flies by. What are you waiting for?
Sandy gave me this letter that she, Judy asked me to read to her brother. She wrote this. She says, if I could give you one thing in life, I would give you the ability to see yourself through my eyes. Only then would you realize how special you are to me. Always keep me in your heart, for you're always in mine. Nothing and nobody, not even time, will ever change that. From childhood memories to adult adventures, I am grateful for every moment with you. The love of a sibling is one of life's greatest blessings. We love you, Bob, Sandy, and Judy. I I'm sure everybody here knows Bob better than I do. But I've listened to a lot of stories about Bob the last couple of days. And what I know is that Bob was a hardworking man. Everybody says that about him. Not surprising, knowing his dad was a blacksmith. Bob was a farmer, he ran a grocery store, he worked heavy machinery. He loved to tinker with firearms, especially turkey loads, I'm told. He liked to work in the garage. And he liked to make things for other people especially. I saw a truck that he made for Case, amazing. Walking stick for Grayson, one of a kind. Made a mask for his sister Sandy, she told me the story. Fourth grade, she needed a mask for school to wear. So Bob went to the garage where he had a coyote hanging. Fashioned it into a mask, and Sandy said she looked like a werewolf. Got second place. It's said that Bob could fix anything, and he was always willing to sacrifice for those he loved. Worked on Derek and Ashley's house for a year just to get it ready to move into. Called his mom every night at 7 o'clock. Sandy called mom every night at 8:30. That's just cool. But he did have a sense of humor. Grayson reminded me he liked to sneak up behind her after he came in from outside and his hands were cold and touch her neck. What I heard about Bob is that he was easy, gentle, and easygoing most of the time, unless you got him right. There was a note that Derek read to me that somebody had written about his dad, and I thought, what a great description. This is a quote. He said, "Your dad was, quote, a big man with a soft voice and a kind heart." What a great way to be remembered, huh?
I've got a friend closer than a brother. There is no judgment. Oh, how he loves me. I've got a friend, and he is my strength. He is my portion. With me in the valley, with me in the fire, with me in the storm. Let all my life testify. Hallelujah. We are not. His mercy is enough. His grace is sufficient. So come if you need it. Forgiveness and healing. His mercy is enough. Oh, and this is our hope. The cross it is spoken. Death is no more. Christ is the Lord. Oh, this is us.
But Jesus came into this world and experienced death. Came into a world where it was common. And Jesus spoke to his disciples about his death that was coming. Sometimes I think maybe it was a new experience for him, but maybe more comfortable because he knew it wasn't the end. He knew there was something after. Jesus attended funerals. We know he raised a widow's son, Jairus' daughter, Lazarus, one of his best friends. He'd been there, he'd seen it, he knew what it was like. But when you understand that life's eternal, it absolutely changes everything. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 says this. It says, "For we know that when this earthly tent that we live in is taken down, that is, when we die and leave this earthly body, we'll have a house in heaven, an eternal body made for us by God himself and not by human hands. We grow weary in our present bodies, and we long to put on our heavenly bodies like new clothing. For we will put on heavenly bodies. We will not be spirits without bodies. And while we live in these earthly bodies, we groan and sigh, but it's not that we want to die to get rid of the bodies that close us. Rather, we want to put on our new bodies, so that these dying bodies will be swallowed up by life. God himself has prepared us for this. As a guarantee, he has given us his Holy Spirit. So we're always confident, even though we know that as long as we live in these bodies, we're not at home with the Lord. For we walk by faith and not by sight. Yes, we're fully confident that we would rather be away from these earthly bodies, for then we would be at home with the Lord. So whether we are here in this body or away from this body, our goal is to praise him. Death was not part of God's plan. It's not the way he created the world. When Adam and Eve were in the garden, they were created to live forever. You and I were created to live forever, not to die. Death was not part of his plan. This is not the way it's supposed to be. It's a result of sin. And that's part of the enemy's plan. And one day, the enemy and death, it says, and Hades will be thrown in the lake of fire. And God will put an end to this. Someday, there'll be no more funerals. Because this is not part of God's plan. It is God's plan that we live forever with him. You know, when we said, you know, if Adam and Eve hadn't done it, it would have been me. All of creation was affected by sin. I can't imagine what the earth was like before sin. But it wasn't like this. Not at all. I think that's why this hurts so bad. Because we know in our spirit this is not the way it's supposed to be. God created us to live forever in a relationship with friends and family forever. Not to be separated. That's why it says in this passage we just read that our spirits groan for the eternal. There's something in us that knows it's there. And we yearn for the day that mortality is swallowed up in life. That mortality won't be a thing anymore, but life will. God's a God of life. Our enemy is all about death. See, God made us for eternity. A lot of people, I think, they face uncertainty or fear even when you talk about death. It's an uncomfortable topic. Some people refuse to think about it until it gets to a time when you don't have much choice. Let me just propose a couple things. Christ, when we believe in him, he changes the picture for the person who's died. You see, it brings an end to pain and suffering. Bob has no pain and suffering any longer. It's amazing, though, in God's mercy, I think he gave Bob time for you to have that conversation with your dad, for Bob to tie up any loose ends and get right with God. Our God's a gracious, merciful God, but he's also gracious and merciful that suffering and pain. Yes. That's a good thing. God brings healing. That's who God is, a healer. And he brings healing to people now and in the future. Did you note in the passage we read that when we die, we get a new body? I'm really hoping for like an Arnold one, okay? But it says we'll be resurrected and glorified like the Son, like Jesus. It calls the bodies we have now just a tent. But that's a temporary dwelling place. But someday we get a house, and that's forever. It's not the same. Philippians says that he will transform our lowly bodies that it may be conformed to his glorious body. He gives us a spirit as a guarantee. And here's what happens. God's Holy Spirit is present with us now, but someday we will be present with him. That's got to be a heck of a lot better. For as many are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God, it says. You see, when you're a believer and you die, you're at home with the Lord. So we read, we're always confident knowing that while we're at home in the body, we're absent from the Lord. So now we walk by faith, not by sight. We're confident and pleased to be absent from the body and to be present from the Lord. Someday, we won't walk by faith. We'll walk by sight. It's better to be with the Lord than to be absent. We were created for fellowship with him. And let me tell you, God can't wait for that to happen. It reminds me this great story, and I want to read this to you. It's so awesome. It says, once upon a time, there were two twin boys. They were conceived in the womb. Seconds, minutes, hours passed as the two embryonic lives developed. The spark of life grew, and each tiny brain began to take shape and form. And with the development of their brain came feeling, and with feeling, perception, a perception of surroundings, of each other, and their own lives. They discovered that life was good, and they laughed and rejoiced in their hearts. But one said to the other, we are sure lucky to have been conceived to have this wonderful world. The other chimed in, yes, blessed be the mother who gave us life and gave us each other. And the twins continued to grow, and soon they had arms and legs and toes that began to take shape, and they stretched their bodies and turned in their little world, and they explored it and found the life cord, which could give them life from their mother's blood. And they were grateful for this new discovery and saying, how great is the love of our mother that she shares all she has with us. Weeks passed into months. And with the advent of each new month, they noticed a change in each other and in themselves. We're changing, one said. What can it mean? It means, said the other, that we're drawing near to birth. An unsettling chill crept over the two. They were afraid of birth, for they knew that it meant leaving their wonderful world behind. Said one, were it up to me, I would live here forever. But we must be born, said the other. It has happened to all the others. Indeed, there was evidence inside the womb that the mother had carried life before. And I believe that there is life after birth, don't you? Well, how can there be life after birth? He cried. He says, Do we not shed the life cord and also the blood tissue when we're born? And have you ever talked to anyone who's been born? Has anyone ever re-entered the womb after birth to describe what birth is like? No. And as he spoke, he fell into despair. And in his despair, he moaned, if the purpose of conception or growth inside the womb is to end at birth, then truly our life is senseless. He clutched his precious life cord to his breast and said, if this is so and life is absurd, then there really can be no mother. But there is a mother, protested the other. Who else gives us nourishment? Who else created the world for us? We get our nourishment from this cord, and the world has always been there, said the woman. And if there is a mother, where is she? Have you ever seen her? Does she ever talk to you? No. We invented the mother when we were very young because it satisfied a need in us. It made us feeling secure and happy. So the other one raved and despaired, and the other resigned himself to birth and placed his trust in the hands of his mother. Hours turned into days, and days into weeks, and soon came the time they both knew their birth was at hand, and they both feared what they did not know. As the one was first to be conceived, so he was the first to be born, and the other following. They cried as they were born into the light. They coughed out fluid, gasped the dry air, and when they were sure they had been born, they opened their eyes, seeing life after birth for the very first time. What they saw was the beautiful eyes of their mother, and they were cradled lovingly in her arms. They were home. If you're a believer, you can say with Paul, I'm hard pressed between the two, having a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better, or to be here. How great thou art, when Christ shall come, a shout of shout of acclamation, and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart, then I shall bow in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. See, not only does Christ change things for the one who's passed, but it also changes the picture for those that are left behind. We rest on Christ's promises. Our suffering and our pain will someday end. We'll someday be with God. We have peace in our hearts. This peace comes from making peace with God. And if you don't make peace with God, you're never going to find it. Isaiah says, you keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. It's a promise from God that peace comes. Striving with God always brings conflict. Not just with God, but in everything else. Peace with God brings peace into every other part of your world. We have the comfort of the Comforter, the Holy Spirit who comes. The assurance that one day we'll go to heaven and be with our Father. The assurance of seeing loved ones again. It's crazy, but death, rightly understood, teaches us how to live. Because of Jesus, we know that death is not the end, it's just the beginning. You see, Christ died too. He overcame death and he rose from the dead. He came back to life. He was the first. He paved the way. The Bible calls him the firstborn of all creation. He is the only way to life is through him, and the only way to live is through Jesus. We read earlier, Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but through me. Jesus lives with an eternal perspective. Jesus understands that this world is not all there is. This is just a dot on the line of eternity. Someday, when we're on the other side, we'll look back and go, what was I so concerned about? Because my life was so short, and I have been here forever. D.L. Moody lived in the 1800s, famous preacher. And so realizing that he was close to death, he said one day to a friend, he said this. He said, someday you're going to read in the papers that D.L. Moody of Northfield is dead. Don't you believe a word of it. He said, at that moment, I shall be more alive than I am now. I shall have gone higher, that is all, out of this old clay tent into a house that is immortal, a body that sin cannot touch, that sin cannot taint, a body fashioned into his glorious body. I was born in the flesh in 1837. I was born in the spirit in 1856. And that which is born of the flesh will die, but that which is born of the spirit will live forever. Jesus came to give us life. That's his great desire. I love what Jimmy Stewart said. He Yeah, it's that Jimmy Stewart, the old actor in the black and white movie, Jimmy Stewart. Let us live as people who are prepared to die, and die as people who are prepared to live. Lord, we thank you for the life of Bob Osborne. Lord, we want to bless you as our God and Father, Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies. You are the God of all comfort, who always comforts us in every affliction we have. Our hope for you, our hope in you, Lord, is unshaken. We know that you share in our sufferings, you're going to share in our comfort. We thank you for being a gracious and merciful God. So amazing. We give thanks to you Thanks for your Son and your Spirit. In the name of your Son, Jesus, we pray.